We'll be right with you, free service guitar lesson.
So you have two empty frets and then dot. Now look at your double dots and see how that the dot pattern repeats. There you go. That's how some of my lessons go. It's like they know all these bits and pieces, but I have to be like, oh. And then, the things they already know how to do.
Interesting.
Good morning, Trinity. Good morning and welcome to God's house today, Trinity Lutheran downtown. We're thankful you're here to worship with us today. In honor of our first song, the beautiful Bible verse, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." We will begin in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Good morning, Trinity. Oh, we can do better than that. Good morning, Trinity. That's it. God's blessings to you. We're glad God's in the house and we're glad you're in God's house. So could you please, please stand and welcome one another now with a handshake of warmth and welcome. Thank you.
thousand and power, our God. Heavenly Father, we repent in joy. We receive the salvation accomplished for us by your beloved Son in all availing sacrifice of his body, his blood on the cross. Be in our midst, enlivening our faith, so we graciously praise and worship you. Let us share your love with others and practice forgiveness as you forgive us through your Son. Now, we prepare our hearts to worship you with joy and perceive your presence among us and recognize that we need you and your help to keep us holding on to you, onto your word, and following Jesus our Savior. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into
Please welcome Cal as this morning's reader.
Good morning, Cal.
Good morning. First reading is from Acts chapter 3, verses 11 through 21. While the lame man who was now healed clung to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them, to the portico called Solomon's, astounded. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this, and why do you stare at us as though by our own power or pity we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. But you denied the holy and righteous one and asked for a murderer to be granted to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witness. And his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see now, and the faith that is now, Jesus has given the man this perfect health in the presence of you all. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as you did also your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of the prophets, that is, Christ would suffer, he thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn again, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all things about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago." This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. "See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that he should be called children, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous as he is righteous." This is the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 24th chapter.
Glory.
They were talking about these things. Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why your trouble? And why do doubts arise from your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalm must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, thus is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance of forgiveness of sin should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witness of these things. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please may be seated.
During this next song, we will collect the prayer cards. If you've something on your heart you'd like the congregation to offer up to our Heavenly Father, pass a card to the elder.
Good morning for those of you who are in the house and online. Welcome to God's house. Take a few moments to fill out the blue cards, as that's the way that we track the attendance for the church. Also, there's a QR code that you can scan, so please do so. If you want to give to Trinity electronically, you can scan the QR code in the bulletin or text 407-809-1560. If you're in need of prayer, an elder will be over on the side to help you with anything you need. The next Family Fun Night will be held Friday, April 19th at 6:30. Please come and join us for food, fellowship, and games. The next voters meeting will be held on April 21st, directly after the 11:15 service. Please plan to stay and be part of the meeting. Also, today is the volunteer lunch, so after the 11:15, those who have signed up, please join. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. And our outreach team is very, very involved. Oh, sorry about that.
Yep.
And we're very glad of that. And I'd like to, just while we're here, we've got the praise team sitting all over here right now. Could we give them a shout out? They've done a wonderful job. And we're just very thankful and appreciative of all you do. And I think we were at elders meeting, Clay, you and I talked, and you said that you've only taken off last year about a couple, 3 weeks or so, and the rest is just everybody coming together and doing what you do and do it so well. So thank you again, and God's blessings. We're very appreciative. And Ash, we're glad you're here with us today. I got it right?
Chris.
See, what?
That's a twin brother, Chris.
Chris, okay.
Ash plays bass.
I'm sure it's not the first time.
Well, you look a lot alike.
They do.
So we're glad to see each of you here also, and we're thankful for that. I do want to say that today we're going to be looking at Acts 4, which is a companion to Acts 3, and we want to just say, so what you've heard in Acts 3 is going to be a part of today's message. So if you want to be walking through this and following along, Acts 4, verses 1 through 12, you got a pew Bible in front of you, and you also then have cell phones. You can even use an Android if you must, okay? It's fine. So I wanted to let you know that. So God's peace, and we're very thankful for your presence here today. I'd like to ask you, how is God showing up in your life and in your world? Greg Finke, a friend and an author, wrote a book called Joining Jesus on His Mission. Many of us here have read that a few years ago. And in it, he asked, how is God messing with you? Kind of a Texan fun guy sort of way of asking, what's God doing in your life? And as we start to look at that and examine it, he encourages believers to take note of how God is touching their life. I call it the fingerprints of God on your life. Where is Jesus Christ at work in your life? In the people you know, the work you do, the things that you are involved with. And he encourages us to join Jesus on his mission as we walk through our everyday life. And I would just like to say as we do that, that what we have is an opportunity to join Jesus, to bear witness to him, to give praise to his name, and to let Jesus do the heavy lifting. If someone would be so kind to get me a Kleenex, I'd greatly appreciate it. Thank you, Bob. I knew I liked you. What's that? No, I'm not crying yet. I've never done that in front of you. Don't bring the one on a roll, though, okay? We call that Kleenex on a roll at my house. So, you have not because you ask not, huh? This is an opportunity for us to tell our story of his story. I wish we had time today just to do something that we used to do in some of our workshops for outreach. What we would do is have you trace the places where God's been at work in your life over the years of your life. And we'd connect the dots of what he has been doing, and then we could be able to tell our story, to be a witness unto him. Telling our story of his story in our life is a very important thing. And that's really where we find Peter and John in Acts 3 and Acts 4. They were trying to explain to now the Jewish Pharisees and Sadducees what had happened the day before when a man who was lame from his birth is healed. You might think about this man who his life consisted of being carried daily to the gate of the temple where he would beg. It didn't appear to be much of a life, but it was the only life he had. The man, hoping to get some money or perhaps food, made eye contact with Peter. And you know, if you're driving down a street where there's all kinds of people put with their signs up asking for money, what is the thing that usually someone in the car will tell you? Don't make eye contact. Peter made eye contact. And Peter said to them, this man, he said, I have no silver and I have no gold, but what I do have, I do give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise and get up, walk. And he took him by the hand and he raised him up. The man's feet immediately and his ankles were made strong. And leaping up, he stood up and began to walk and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God, and they recognized him as the beggar at the temple gate. He is now standing and walking and even leaping. A miracle, we could all say and attest to. Their message was resonating with the people and was rapidly spreading. And then what we have in Acts 4:1 is, as they were speaking to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them. Now, what do we know about the Sadducees? If you're in confirmation class, why are the Sadducees, what's their characteristic? They're sad because they don't believe in the resurrection. And so what we see is they were greatly annoyed because the disciples, Peter and John, were teaching the people and proclaiming Jesus and the resurrection from the dead. And they arrested them and then they put them in custody. And since it was late in the evening, they decided to talk with them the next day. But many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of those who believed were about 5,000 men. How were Jesus' disciples going to deal with this? The disciples were preaching that Christ, who had been crucified 3 days earlier, now at this point on the timeline, a little later than this, they were preaching that Jesus Christ had actually been raised on the third day. And that Jesus Christ was the one that was now alive, who had defeated all their notions that there was no resurrection from the dead. Christ had turned that upside down by proving that the tomb was empty, by showing himself to be alive to the disciples. And that's what we read in the gospel. Thomas would ask, where can I put my finger into his hands? And unless I do, or my hand into his side, I will not believe. Jesus had answered all those questions. And now the disciples are sharing this wondrous good news. The high priest and all who were with the high priest's family gathered and asked Peter, by what power or in what name are you doing this? Like I said last week, God showed up. God showed up in their world and he allowed them to see what was going on. Jesus would again calm their fears and their doubts. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to these leaders, rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means he has been raised, let it be known to you and all the people of Israel that this Jesus Christ of Nazareth is the one who is responsible for healing this man, whom you crucified, but who God raised from the dead. This man now is standing before you and is well. This Jesus is the very stone, the chief cornerstone, rejected by you, the builders, which has now become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, given under heaven nor among men, by which we must be saved. Scripture tells us that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And that was settled then and there at Easter. It was settled then and there at the cross. It was settled then and there now in this healing. And it's been settled for some 2,000 plus years. That Jesus Christ is the only remedy for our sins. Jesus Christ is the only answer to death. Jesus Christ is the only one who can heal beyond all hope and power and authority. and nothing, including death, can defeat him or us. Jesus did it. This man stands undeniably well before you today, the disciples said. Jesus is alive. Jesus is the cornerstone, and God's salvation rests upon and comes from him. I look at the man of this story, and I see the magnitude of this miracle. Can you imagine what it must have meant for this man who was physically one day standing, but all the rest of his life had only been sitting, waiting for others to carry him? Now he was walking and even leaping, going from a beggar to a believer, from weakness to strength. His feet and his ankles would hold his body. I know this man's daily prayer for sustenance and help must have been a constant thing. I see how huge this miracle must have been, for he had prayed with Jesus' intervention that his life now was forever changed. I know how I've prayed for my feet and my ankles. I want you to know that too, I too, like this man, want to praise God for orchestrating help, for Jesus showing up through others to help me. Several weeks ago, one of our members, Dr. Bierman, was present, and he said, "What's going on with your foot?" And I told him, and he referred me that day to a surgeon that will do my surgery. He said, "Here's a referral, a number," and he gave that number to me, and I called it, and I got right in. I worried and I fretted also about what this would mean for Trinity and for me and our ministry together. And after sharing it with our leadership, I'm proud and pleased to say, as I share it now again with you as congregation, God showed up again, telling me through you to get it done, to do it as soon as possible, we'll be okay, and get back as soon as you can. But be ready, you know, don't come back too soon. We want you well." My friends, that was love. Love poured out upon me in very real ways. It calmed my fears, my doubts, my worries, and gave me a renewed strength of hope and vigor. That was such a blessing. To be able to think about returning back with more mobility, with less pain. I moved to a new worry, however. How in the world am I going to do this and be non-weight-bearing for a number of weeks? God blessed us with another member, another doctor, Dr. Hanekom, who's with us here today. And she knows, by the way, the Trinity handshake. Her son taught it to her and her daughter. She said, "What's going on?" And so I told her, and she says, "Do you realize what I do?" I said, "No, I know you're a doctor, but I don't know." She says, "Well, I deal with rehabilitation. And I work with doctors that you're going to." And she said, "We can work together on a rehab therapy. And I'll point out some of the things you could do to help that transition." All the time, do you see what God was doing? He was surrounding me with people who would help me navigate these troubling waters that I was so fearful of. Desiree, my beloved for 48 years, has helped me greatly also with the desire to lose some weight to help in our recovery and to get some of my numbers right. And I began to pray more, journal more, read my Bible, all of which God brought countless blessings to me. And then so often I hear from you, "We're praying for you, Pastor." I thank you for that. I thank you. It was one of our members, who's a new member actually, who had hip surgery this past Friday, Alan Kimmel. Alan called me on Friday after he got home from hip surgery. And he said, I'm home. I said, you're home? He said, yeah. I walked into my kitchen. I'm calling you from there. I said, well, how did it go? He said, it went fine. God got me through. And as we talked about it, we were reminded of Hebrews 11. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things that you don't see and don't have. But to know because it's you with God, God will get you through it. Trusting and believing in Him. And I know the one whom I trust, and so does Alan. Paul also says in Romans 5, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, the ability to go on, get through it. And endurance produces character, and character, hope. And as you and I have walked several things together, I know some of you are characters too. That God has gotten you through tough times. God has worked in your life. And as you and I start to examine and look at our lives, we see the fingerprints of God touching our lives over the days and years and months that we walk this journey called faith. I preach to you what is found in Luke 24. Repentance and forgiveness of sins in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. That's whose name and in whose name, like the man of today's text, I will be made well and you will have your prayers answered for your lives as well. In the name of Jesus, God bless you all and thank you. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the true faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. And thank you for the Kleenex.
The offering will be collected during this next song. We contribute our gifts to the work of God's kingdom. And feel free to join us in song as we lift our Father's name on high.
Sing your praise.
We lift in the name of our Lord. We lift the name of our God to the higher with faith. So let us proclaim our faith using the word of the Apostle Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, making a heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He was standing on the hill, in the same there. He ascended into heaven, and sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and he sent to come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we bring the prayers of the church to you for your consideration. Lord, we pray for AJ and his family as they go through personal struggles. Comfort them and guide them as only you know how, and be with them. And Lord, please cover those in Israel with your love and protection. Please help them to seek you and to turn to you. Please, God, turn the hearts of those who would seek to destroy your holy people, your Israel. And Lord, also be with those hostages that are still being held and help them to be released soon. And Lord, please fill the hearts and minds of our nation and the world leaders, and please fix their eyes upon you, seeking your direction and your mercy. And Lord, we'd like to thank you for the volunteers here at Trinity. Bless their efforts and keep them encouraged as they serve your mission. Lord, in your mercy.
Almighty God, have compassion for all of those who are broken health or a spirit. We present before you our brothers in Christ, Pastor Doug Allison. Father, you have promised to hear the petition of those who ask in your Son's name. We humbly thank you for having heard our prayer for your servant, Pastor Doug, and for answering him according to your will. But we keep asking your Father to continue supplying him on his need from your mercy, and that he may evermore praise and glorify your holy name. We also ask you to share your peace with him and help him to not raise doubt in his heart, to reminding him that you are always with him. Use us as your instrument to show care, love, and support to him while he facing challenge. And we also ask you, we pray for him and for his family. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, it is difficult to live peacefully in this world, full of uncertainty, hatred, violence, and on the social network, and the news there are constant examples of rude, threatening, and destructive. Have mercy on our fallen world, and Father, look upon Israel, and manifest your presence in the mercy, with mercy and peace, and keep them and us away from evil and danger. Only in your hand are we confident, because you and because of Jesus, we are sure of your forgiveness and your salvation. With your Spirit, bless us with your peace and hope. Keep our family and friendship under your care. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, teach us how to pray Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our brothers and sisters, we read from the scripture that on the night our Lord was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciple and said, take it. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, take it, drink it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
You may be seated. Welcome to the table of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord may his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Could we give a wonderful Trinity family appreciation to Chris for filling in today for Crystal? Thank you, Chris. Appreciate it very much. Fasten your seatbelts, y'all. This one's taking you for a ride. One.
Go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills will break forth before you. There'll be shouts of joy, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Trees of the field will clap their hands. Trees of the field will clap their hands. Will you go out with
and serve the Lord with joy.